If I can break into the software engineering world without a computer science degree, then so can you. With so many computer science or equivalents in job postings, it seems discouraging. But in today's video, I'm gonna be giving you a practical roadmap that you can use to teach yourself how to code with the intention of getting you a job. If you're new here, then hi, my name is Lewis, and I'm on a mission to inspire developers and tech enthusiasts. In the world of software engineering, there's a ton of different roles that you can pursue. Front end, back end, QA, like there's so much. So before we even touch this roadmap, let's figure out what our end goal should be. If you love those crazy animated websites, or if you're into clean, sleek, and aesthetic user interfaces, sounds like front end is for you. No eye for design, no problem. Choose back end if you really want to get stuck under the hood. And if you don't know, I have a video describing what programming language you should learn based off of the industry that interests you the most. So check that out if you want. For the remainder of this video, I'm just going to be referencing full stack developer just because it kind of wraps around everything. However, this roadmap isn't geared towards any specific industry. Learn how to program. So our first priority is how to program as well as how to think like a programmer. No matter what level you are in your career, you're always going to be learning something new. Software engineering requires a deep understanding of how computers read code. So start with a programming language and do not, I repeat, do not spend too much time thinking about what programming language you should learn. In my humble opinion, you should start with JavaScript or Python. And I have two reasons for this. One, they're the most popular languages, meaning it'll be much easier to find resources to help you become more fluent. And two, concepts like variables, data types, functions are already in these languages and translates elsewhere. Of course, learn any programming language that you want to learn, like I'm not your boss. Here are some resources where you can learn programming. For books, No Starch Press has some great options. Specifically, look for the beginner books that are targeted towards new programmers. Bootcamps are going to be more pricey, but the accountability is great if you can fork out that cash. And if you're into video tutorials, I recommend Zero to Mastery, which I've used before, but is also the sponsor of today's video. Listen, there's a ton of different videos on YouTube, Udemy, Twitter, whatever, but none have the intentions of helping you use these new skills that you just developed. Zero to Mastery's entire philosophy revolves around outcome-based results, meaning that their courses are designed to help you get hired rather than just learn a skill you can show at a party. Sorry, are programmers getting invited to parties? Asking for a friend. You can take their free career path quiz that will literally give you a personalized career roadmap based on your goals and experience, which hopefully you did the step before. Just follow along the courses, projects, and interview prep to land your dream job. And if you ever get stuck along the way, which, you know, happens to the best of us, their community of over 400,000 students are here to help answer any questions. Something I love is they've added a dedicated project section where they've been launching a new project you can build every week. Nothing beats learning by doing, and these projects are also a great way to build up your portfolio and confidence. So if you want to learn the most in-demand skills, like literally, I just saw a course go up that was about large language models, then Zero to Mastery is an incredible resource for new or existing developers like myself who want to constantly stay ahead. To get started with their courses and working towards landing a job as a software engineer, which by the way, can make up to $100,000 per year. It'll only cost you, wait a minute, $23 a month? How do these guys even make any money? Graduates from Zero to Mastery have landed positions at Tesla, Amazon, Google, and more. Use the code in the description below to level up your career and support the channel. 30 days money back guaranteed. Thanks again to Zero to Mastery for supporting the channel. Once you've read a book or done a course of some sort, you'll have some familiarity with how the programming language works. Let's go to the next step. Building a portfolio. You're probably thinking, build a portfolio? Like, I have no idea what I'm doing. Well, the good news, neither do I. There are many reasons to start a portfolio really early. One, it helps you build a community, which, speaking of community, I have a Discord channel with over 9,000 other developers that love to code, so I would be happy if you would join. Two, it helps you communicate abstract ideas in ways that are understandable to a general audience. And three, you can knock out a project and create a portfolio in one go. Now, if I were to start over, this is how I would structure it. I would create a webpage that has a homepage, a blog page, and a projects page. This would mean that I can have a little blurb about me, I can start blogging to get my ideas and learning out into the world, then a project page so I can showcase some of my amazing things that I've worked on. If you want to build your own website, you can use HTML, CSS, and JavaScript. You can also learn some advanced frameworks like Next.js or Jekyll. But if you really just want something up and fast, then something like Ghost or WordPress are two of my favorites. This portfolio is gonna act like our diary moving forward. We'll keep coming back to this like it's our home and continue to update it so that in the future, we can prove that we have the experience and that we know what we're talking about. Build beginner projects. You probably built some projects in the courses that you took, but water wings are coming off. We're diving straight into the deep end, whether you like it or not. Sorry. That was weird. Don't be alarmed though, it's extremely common in software engineering to go into something without experience and needing to understand the requirements of how to get it done. We have to set goals because if you thought you were learning during a course, well then this, well, you're gonna learn 10 times easier. Here are three ways you are going to get a beginner project idea. One, use ChatGPT to find some. Two, think of something easy you would like to use. And three, use this open source repository to help you get started. Now, I love this repository right here, but please use this carefully. Each of these resources are linked with pages on how you can build it, which is going to take away from your learning. Just use the titles as ideas and see what you think. Here's how you're gonna be successful with this. Let's grab an idea using method one. ChatGPT. I ask it for a list of beginner ideas. All right, I like this. Expense tracker. All right, an expense tracker. Interesting. We would want to accept input like the expense, the category of it, and the price. We can then maybe get a detailed output after we are done inserting. So I don't know about you, but my stupid little Pea-Brain right here freezes under pressure. So I would recommend breaking this down into micro tasks. Let me show you. One, create input for expense, price, and category. Two, parse input and lowercase all values. Three, store in a file type so we can access it later. Four, import that file type and get all expenses under a certain category and get the sum. And then five, show the user the output. What might have seemed like an overwhelming one app is now being broken down into five micro applications. Also, we just have some ideas for a blog and portfolio. Best way to ask for multiple input in Python. Best ways to store data that isn't a database. Beautiful output in Python. Guys, I'm being serious here. Communicating to an audience really helps you learn throughout your entire process. And this diary approach that we're taking is gonna create a breadcrumb for your whole entire programming journey, which also means that people know what you're talking about. And finding an idea and breaking it down into a bunch of small pieces is gonna help you code 20 times better. And don't be scared to read documentation. Next step. Learn more advanced topics and databases. Okay, you started building some amazing beginner projects and you kind of feel like a badass, which good for you. I think you should feel like that. So in my example that I mentioned with the full stack developer, well, we can then go into more advanced topics of Python, like Python as a web server, databases, algorithms. Again, I have a more dedicated video to becoming a full stack developer, a front end developer, a back end developer, whatever. But here's the spark notes on this. Software is often built with many moving parts at the same time. So let's start moving towards that by building a back end web server with Python. Let's think about how an application would work. You have a smartphone, a microcomputer, a website, whatever talking to a server. In that server, some computation happens and gathers memory from a database. This architecture is simple, but keep this in your head when you think of developing apps. If I wanted to learn advanced Python, for example, I would expand into WSGI, which would be Flask or Django. Databases, SQL or NoSQL. API development, how can you get all the pieces of software to talk to each other? And if you haven't learned about classes or object-oriented, then now's the time to do so. Also, start looking into data structures and algorithms. Realistically, at this point in your journey, you definitely have stumbled across them a little bit, but they're an absolute essential to computer science, but even just a glance of this will really help you with your coding journey. But stay tuned for that. This is where it becomes really important to have an end goal. If you want to be a full stack developer, then learn what I said above. If you want to be in game development, learn more advanced concepts in your programming language or engine. The possibilities are endless, but here are some general resources that will work most of the time. Most books on No Starch Press have an advanced version in most programming languages. Zero to Mastery also have some advanced topics you can use as well. Or join a coding community and see what other people are working on and what is required to make that. Build an advanced app. You're back in the scenario now where you've learned a lot, but need to take off your water wings. Well, in this case, take your water wings off and strap some bricks to your feet. Sorry, was that too far? At this rate, you've learned a lot. You'll understand how technology works together to create a harmonious app and feel like you have the potential to be its orchestrator. I just made that up on the fly, by the way. We can do what we did before. We can also find inspiration in open source again. I like this project called Build Your Own X, but beware, it gets pretty nuts. Build an OS with Rust? Like, I wanna go outside once every 3 days at least. Let's take the same idea you had in the beginner project and expand it with the new technology you just learned. Imagine if the expense tracker that we made in the first app had a web form that you could fill out and then talked to a server with an API and then had a database that was able to store this information as well as crunch some numbers on the spot. The same philosophy applies when building. Break it down with your dumb little pea brain. Well, sorry, I have the pea brain. You're probably a little bit smarter than I am. So create a form of three inputs. Write a function that sends an HTTP request with all the data. Write a Flask application that accepts that information and parses it. Format this to accept into an SQL query. Write a query to get all existing inputs. Sum it all together. Serialize output into JSON and send back to the user. And display the results in a fancy way. Again, this method allowed us to chop away at it just one piece at a time, but it also gives us some business and communication tools as well by breaking down things into a scope and how much you can execute it. I am once again going to bother you about the portfolio and blog. With this experience of building this app comes a lot of great knowledge that you can share. Best packages to create forms, most secure ways to insert SQL, JSON serializing for beginners, etc. This constant feedback and validation you'll receive from this is what will help you gather authority to keep moving forward and connect with other like-minded developers. Something we haven't even discussed yet is working as a team. Your blog and portfolio will help you with this whole communication aspect, but it's really important to learn tools like Git, for example. This will be key, especially for the next step. Getting experience. How can an entry-level job require experience when I need that job to get experience? I hate that I have to say this, but it's the sad reality. No education and no experience is considered a risk to employers. And realistically, this shouldn't be true because graduates could have just flown under the radar, but that degree is serious authority. Just a disclaimer, this is what I did, and if you can, please avoid this as much as possible, but I had to work for free to prove myself. As a young person, I needed people to have a no-risk attitude when it came to hiring me. So I would often do small jobs for small businesses to help with this. I'm very privileged to be in a situation where I could work for free, so please, never aim to work for free. Gain some real life experience by consulting with small businesses that often face software issues. These can range from simple connectivity between two software applications to adding a small input form on a website that can be printed out. By offering to solve a small problem for a client, you can gain valuable experience working with real world requirements. So let's say, for example, they wanted to print in real time when a web form submission happened. Again, Pea-Brain mentality. How can we do this? Create a service in the middle or on the server that parses all of the data. Once it is parsed correctly, send it to the computer in the office and format on letterhead paper. Print and save somewhere that the job was a success. Gluing two things together is arguably some of the most effective way that you can gain real-world experience with small businesses. It's also small enough to the point where you don't have to slave away building an application that someone asked you to do. Another way you can get experience is by contributing to open source. Go to GitHub issues of any decent sized project and it will be swarmed with bugs. This could be a good opportunity to work with code in the real world and provide your input. I will say that this method is a little bit tougher just because you have to be familiar with the project, but it's still incredible nonetheless. Computer science related topics. Now, all the advice that have led up to this moment have been extremely practical, and that's on purpose. But the word software engineer is extremely controversial, and it's because of that one word, engineer. Computer science is an extremely dense topic that often involves a lot of theory and abstract concepts. However, it's extremely important to have at least a surface level understanding of computer science, especially going into your interview or even diving deep into your code. For example, how does a network work? What responsibilities does your operating system handle? File systems, computer architectures, maybe even cloud computing. My recommendation when it comes to learning computer science is to start with roadmap.sh's self-learning computer computer science charts, and it provides a lot of resources and links on each subject that you click on. Also, look into the Open Source Society University's computer science course. In that course, some of the things overlap with what we've already discussed, so be a bit selective with it. I'm a big fan of the calculus and math courses specifically for this reason, so make sure you take that and catch up on math. Interview prep. Your community involvement and blog posts show that you're skilled at communicating what you know. You have been doing that, right? So if you get overwhelmed in an interview, well, we've already discovered the method of breaking things down, the Pea-Brain method. That way, you don't have to practice. Okay. I'm joking. Time to wake up. Now is your time to practice more theoretical programming problems to show employers that you know what you're talking about. At this stage, hopefully you have some experience, which will let you explain to employers how you're able to take requirements and translate it over into the real world. Technical interviews may or may not be something that you have to do depending on where you get a job, but it's still worth taking time out of your day to keep your brain on alert. And I mean, let's be real here, it's just good for your brain in general. If this is the moment you have to prove yourself, you want to make the best impression possible. It's really important to not be discouraged in this moment. You may struggle in your first 10 interviews. Just keep going and learn from your mistakes. That's all you can do, and you'll just ultimately be a better person by the end of it. Eventually, you'll get that reply back saying that you got the job. Here are just some sample ways on how you can prep. Leak code. This one is memed everywhere online, but there's a great collection of resources to do technical interviews, so use them at your disposal. Mock interviews. Get a friend to download an interview sheet and have them quiz you on the spot. One of my favorites, the Tech Interview Handbook. It's an open source handbook that will give you practical tips on resume building, algorithms, and more. An incredible resource, so definitely check that one out. Zero to Mastery. Zero to Mastery has a course where you can master the tech interview specifically with large tech companies like Google, Facebook, etc. Congratulations. It was a long journey, but your passion and dedication did it for you. Keep learning. Great, you landed the job. Why are you still watching this video though? A misconception I always had when it came to working in the software engineering industry was that eventually I was going to get good and that this whole learning process will finally go away. So if that's you and you're feeling this way, come here for a sec. That feeling never goes away. Software engineering is a field that is constantly throwing things at you that you have never even seen before. But I mean, let's turn this into a positive though. The feeling of constantly having to learn and expand our knowledge is ultimately an extremely rewarding experience. My biggest takeaway from this video is that experience is the biggest leverage that you can have when it comes to working in the software engineering industry. My roadmap is a very practical guide on how you can get experience as fast as possible. In computer science, there's a ton of things that you will need to learn, but my roadmap is a very practical guide on how you can get experience as fast as possible so you can get a job. I hope this roadmap was valuable to you and helped inspire you to either learn programming or get into the industry. If you want something a little bit more laser focused in an industry, well, I have a full stack developer roadmap or a backend developer roadmap. So make sure you check that out on my channel. Peace out, coders.